What's My Line? Brought to you by Geritol, the high-potency vitamin iron-rich tonic in liquid or tablets to help you feel stronger. And now, let's all play What's My Line? And now, from New York, let's meet our What's My Line panel. First, the delightful star of stage and television, Miss Arlene Francis.
Thank you. And now a gentleman who is always a pleasure for me to introduce, Mr. Martin Gable.
On my left, one of America's most famous columnists, Dorothy Kilgallen.
And on my left, my favorite publisher, Random House's Bennett Cerf.
And here's our panel moderator, third assistant quarterback on the Tilton Prep School scrub team, John Charles Daly.
The bitter truth is that Bennett's just jealous because Tilton School won again this weekend. We beat Proctor, so there. I must say, Martin, as always, it's a joy to see you on the panel. I think we've got some occupations that will give you some fun, and I trust a little testing in the next half hour.
Thank you, Tom.
We will also have a famous mystery guest before my friends on the panel a little bit later in the program, and we'll meet our first challenger after... And now to meet our first contestant. Will you enter and sign in, please?
Colonel Harland Sanders. Is that right, sir?
Right.
Colonel Sanders, would you tell us where you're from?
I'm from Shelbyville, Kentucky.
Shelbyville, Kentucky.
That's right.
And what part of the state is that, sir?
That's on the west central side, near Louisville, Kentucky.
Near Louisville?
Yeah, 29 miles from Louisville.
Lovely country. It's nice
to have you. May I present the panel, Colonel?
Now, would you join me over here, please, sir?
The next thing I think that we need to do, really, is to let the audience here in the theater and the audience at home know exactly what your line is. Panel, we can tell you that Colonel Sanders is self-employed and deals in a product, and we'll begin the general questioning with Arlene Francis.
Colonel, I don't know what you do, but I think you look too beautiful to work.
I do plenty of work.
Is your product anything that I might use?
Yes, ma'am. I hope you do.
Is it any product that I could hold in my hand?
Yes.
Is it anything that I would put into my mouth?
Yes, indeed.
I would eat it or drink it?
You would eat it.
Thank you, Colonel. I know you're a Southern gentleman now.
I'm just going to flip a few cards on that account, I think, just for fun.
Is it something that I might have in association with the main meal?
Yes, ma'am.
Is it a grain rather than a meat or a vegetable?
That makes it five down and five to go, Mr. Gable.
Is this wonderful foodstuff of yours, does it grow in Kentucky, Colonel?
Yes, it does.
Is it improved by that famous bluegrass of Kentucky?
Yes.
Let me have a small conference with the Colonel.
Horse meat.
Actually, would you ask the question again? Because the Colonel wants to be sure that he answered it correctly.
Well, I know that your great state has marvelous soil, that famous bluegrass of Kentucky, as a number of other things. But is this product of yours, which is not meat and not grain...
No, which is not grain.
Miss Francis, now I think that the marital relationship with Mr. Gable here shouldn't be allowed to the table.
I think it's just come to an end, John.
I knew that pillow talk was going to get out of this project.
No, actually, Martin, Arlene is right. It's, what has been elicited is that it is not grain.
But it does grow in the bluegrass of Kentucky.
Mm-hmm.
Is it good for animals as well as people, Colonel?
No, not so well.
I don't think we could say so. No, six down and four to go, Miss Kilgallen.
Well, if it's not grain, but it grows, is it either a fruit or a vegetable?
Neither.
That makes it seven down and three to go, Mr. Sir.
Colonel, I am going to ask you a question. If you don't make this product, you should. Is it ever used in connection with that marvelous drink, mint juleps?
Well, some people may have a mint julep preceding you.
To that extent, Bennett, you were saved by the bell. Because
I didn't quite hear the answer. That
well, the colonel said if somebody might have a mint julep preceding or in connection with it.
Oh, but it is not used in the mint julep itself, is
no,
that
no,
correct?
No,
yes, it
oh,
is not.
Oh, dear. Is it used at cocktail parties, Colonel?
Yes, it could be.
Could be. Mm-hmm.
Is it served cold rather than hot?
Either way, it
could be.
Mm-hmm. Is there Martin jumped the gun before, and I will now ask you, might it be described as meat?
As what?
As meat.
Yes.
It could be described as meat.
Growing meat?
Well, you asked if the judge, the basic
there.
Product here grew, and we agreed that the basic
is it ever encased, Colonel, in a skin of any kind?
I didn't understand.
Is it encased in a skin of any kind?
No, no.
Only when
well.
It's grown.
Well, it's got its own skin, yeah.
Yeah, we'll agree to that.
Very nice save, Colonel, if I do say it. Very
yes,
nice save.
Yes, I've been saved by the bell several times, Colonel. does this thing leap about when it's alive?
No, not exactly leap.
Well,
I must say this. I guess, Colonel, we'd have to agree that you could, in a very general sense, say once in a while they might be describing as leaping about.
Yes. Yeah, I guess you got saved again, Bennett.
Colonel, is this possibly in the rabbit family?
No, no, that's it. Not a shooting of Miss Francis.
Would it ever be used in sausage?
No, never.
Oh,
no,
I should say not. Nine.
They use everything in sausage.
That's what Mr. Gable was going to say. Mr. Gable.
Colonel, could it ever have been a horse?
Dorothy?
Wild guess, turkeys?
Well, you're closer
fowl.
Than anybody. Fried chicken now.
What's the matter with you all?
You haven't heard of that finger-licking good Kentucky fried chicken?
That's the colonel's company, actually.
I just don't think of it growing out of the blue grass.
Well, I don't either, but
it
you
feeds
see,
on the blue grass.
It feeds on. Now, Martin asked if it had any, if it used the grass. The colonel says they do pick at grass, and we were talking about chickens, and they do grow. I think we can all agree on that.
Nice, quiet chickens that don't leap, we understand.
Somehow, well, I never associate fried chicken with mint julep. I don't think they go well together, Colonel.
You said you'd have the julep prior to eating the chicken dinner scene. Now, this
and
is Kentucky Fried Chicken. It's different than ordinary
See, that's
fried
the
chicken.
Colonel's company. It's Kentucky Fried Chicken. Just Kentucky Fried Chicken. And he's been so successful with it, he has it now in take-home stores and other places of franchise to do it, make it his way. Where they get
how many spices? There's
11
different spices and herbs and a patented method of frying. We have over 900 outlets all the way from Honolulu to Blackpool and London and Manchester, England, all across Canada.
So there we are.
And all of a sudden, wherever you see a picture of this mug of mine, you know you're going to get good food, at least good chicken.
Thank you very much, Colonel. It was
Thank
nice to have you with us. Now to meet our second contestant. Will you enter and sign in, please?
Paula? Murphy. How do you do? Miss or Mrs.?
Miss.
Miss Murphy. And where are you from, Miss Murphy?
Granada Hills, California.
Granada Hills, California. May I present our panel, Miss Murphy?
How do you do?
Now, would you join me over here?
Granada Hills up south or down north?
The San Fernando Valley.
San Fernando Valley. That's fine. That's over across. I knew that I'd find this all out in good order. Now, we'll let the audience at home and the audience in the theater know exactly what your line is.
I'll tell you that Miss Murphy is salaried and deals in a service, and we'll begin the general questioning with Bennett Cerf.
Miss Murphy, you look like one of those healthy Jansen bathing suit California girls.
Thank you.
Do you perform your service outdoors?
Yes, I do.
Is there any kind of athletic skill or prowess required in the service that you perform?
Yes.
In a general way, now, Bennett, I don't want to mislead you. We're assuming here that you're asking whether you have to be...
physical.
In good physical condition and respond quickly and things like that.
Miss Murphy, are you connected in any way with tourism or transportation?
Yes.
Transportation?
Yes.
Do you operate some kind of vehicle?
Yes.
Would it be a vehicle rather for merchandise and material than a vehicle that carries human passengers?
No.
One down and nine to go, Miss Prentice.
You carry passengers, then, in your vehicle. Would you be liable to carry more than two or three passengers?
No.
Two down and eight to go, Mr. Gable.
Does your vehicle fly rather than stay on the ground?
No.
Three down and seven to go, Miss Kilgallen.
Miss Murphy, would it be against the law if you took off?
What did you have in mind, Dorothy?
Well, this is a little bit hard, Dorothy.
Getting above the ground. I mean, if may I ask, does this vehicle have any wheels?
Yes.
Well, that rules out sleds. That's good. Well, if your wheels left the ground for any protracted time, would you be likely to get some sort of a summons from the police department?
Well, if she was around thereafter to get the summons, I think it's pretty likely she might get one, yeah.
All right. Is this vehicle something on land rather than in the water?
Yes.
Is it smaller than a bus?
Yes.
Is it about the size of a taxi cab?
Approximately,
yeah, generally speaking.
But from your hesitancy and John's concurrence thereof, may I assume it is not, in truth, a taxi cab?
Yes.
Yes.
Is it a rickshaw?
No.
No. That's four down and six to go, Mr. Sir.
Miss Murphy, does this vehicle have a motor?
Yes, it does.
Is the motor in the front part of the vehicle?
Yes.
Does the vehicle in any way or shape come under the heading of an automobile?
Yes.
But it is not a bus. It is not a taxi cab.
You're right.
You drive it?
Yes, I do.
Do you get paid for driving it?
Yes, I do.
Who pays you? Do you work for yourself?
No.
No service?
No.
Do you work for a profit-making organization?
Yes, I do.
Is this profit-making organization in the general transportation business of some sort?
Yes, it is.
Would it have anything to do with a drive-it-yourself car or something of that sort?
No.
Nope. Five down and five to go, Miss Francis.
Now, you said you would not take more than two or three people at a time. Is it possible that you might take less than three people?
Yes.
Might you just have one other person go with you on this trip, on this drive? Human being.
Sometimes.
Are there ever any animals traveling with you?
No.
Six down and four to go. I'm going to give you one more minute, Mr. Gable.
Does the transportation company you work for another company, like a movie company?
No.
Seven down and three to go, Miss Kilgallen.
Are the people that you drive grown-ups, usually.
Those who would ride in the automobile with me would be grown-ups, yes.
Are they ever people who might not have licenses themselves to drive?
No.
Eight down and two to go. Bennett, you want to take a shot?
Yes, I'd like a quick shot. Have you got something to do with teaching other people how to drive a car?
No.
No.
Can I take one more
shot?
You don't drive a golf automobile.
No, you're skirting all around. Test driver.
Oh, test driver.
Miss Murphy is employed. Miss Murphy is employed by Studebaker and drove October 17th of this year an Avanti at an average speed of 161.29 miles per hour to win the woman's speed record for driving this kind of a car on the Bonneville Salt Flats. Is that right?
So there you go.
My wife drives faster than that.
Who are Miss Murphy's passengers usually?
When she's a test driver, sometimes she will have somebody with her when they're testing a car to take notes and that sort of thing. Remember, we just said less than three was all we said, right? Thank you very much, Miss Murphy. We fooled them, and it's a joy to do it. Nice to have had you with us. We'll meet tonight's mystery guest in just a moment, but first, here is a word from our sponsor. Now we come to the special feature of our program, the appearance of our mystery challenger, for which my friends are always blindfolded. Are the blindfolds in place, panel?
Yes.
Yes, John.
Good. Will you enter, mystery challenger, and sign in, please? Case one question at a time, in turn, moving clockwise, and we'll begin with Dorothy Kilgallen.
Are you a movie star?
No, sometime, but not really.
One down and nine to go, Mr. Sir.
Have you ever been graced this panel with your distinguished presence?
I have. Sometime long ago, I was on the panel, yes.
Ms. Francis.
Are you now playing on Broadway in a play?
No, I am not. I am not engaged now in a play.
Two down and eight to go, Mr. Gable.
Do you bear a royal name which is not Queen?
I frequent the same bars as Martin.
Alan King.
Alan King. Yes.
I thank you to keep your mouth shut.
Alan has recently come to New York to be in the Empire Room at the Waldorf, and there's a lot of written about you. I was reading the Herald Tribune a couple of Sundays ago and said that you were called Mr. Suburbia. Did you know that?
Well, I've been given titles like the Crabgrass Comic and Mr. Suburbia. As long as they keep writing about me, I don't care what the title is.
But the genesis of this, Alan, is that you do a social comment in your humor.
I started by talking about the suburbs, and now I've sort of branched out and I've taken on other targets.
Oh.
Been very... paid off very well in money, but I've also had several lawsuits, so it balances itself.
Well, I know that you've got some plans. I don't know whether I'm talking out of school because some mutual friends told me about this. You're going to do a series, aren't you, on television?
Hopefully. Yes, well, I thought it was going to be a secret until Miss Kilgallen ran it in the column. Well, I'm very fortunate in having Nat Hiken, who is, as you know, one of the real great comedy minds. And we are in the midst of creating a show right now, which we hope to go on, but you know.
In the next season.
I've lost more pilots than the Luftwaffe, so.
Just for the few uninitiated, a pilot is a test program that you make, hoping to get on to the following season. So that's a wonderful
turn. Then you do it for 6 weeks, and the Nielsen rating comes out, and then you start again.
No, actually, I think the way to do it is to do 29, you see, if you can get away with it. And then not worry about it, leave the country.
Well, we'll have to read the Journal American and see what Dorothy has to say about a starting date. And
I read it, too, just to find out what I'm going to do.
What you're going to do. And thanks an awful lot, Alan.
Thank you.
Joining us.
Much.
Good to have you on. Well, we got to admit that was quite a brilliant recovery panel, so I'll give you some congratulations, and we'll have another contestant after this word from our alternate sponsor. And now to meet a final contestant. Will you enter and sign in, please? Shirley? Hirschberg, right? Is it Miss or Mrs.
It's
Hirschberg?
Miss.
And where are you from, Miss Hirschberg?
New York City.
New York City?
Yes.
Oh, well, these are all neighbors, but may I formally present you anyway, Miss Hirschberg, to Pamela. And now will you join me over here, please? We'll let the audience in the theater and the audience at home. I know exactly what your line is. All right. Now we can tell you that Miss Hirschberg is salaried and deals in a service, and we'll begin the general questioning with Martin Gable.
Thank you, John. Miss Hirschberg, would I have to come to you for your service?
No.
I don't think we could say so. I don't think you'd like to, Martin, if you wanted it. Let's put it that way. Miss Kilgallen.
Miss Hirschberg, do you ever wear anything except an ordinary street dress in your work?
No.
Two down and eight to go, Mr. Surf.
Miss Hirschberg, do you work for a profit-making organization?
No.
Three down and seven to go, Miss Francis.
Do you work for some branch of the government?
Yes.
Do you work for the city government?
Yes.
But you are never seen in a uniform or anything like that?
No.
Do people come to you for your service?
Some do.
But you can go to them?
Yes.
In fact, it is more usual for you to go to them, is it?
Yes.
Uh-huh. Are they unhappy to see you when you show up?
No.
No?
Well, I would say that some of those who might have some relationship in regard to the norm of your everyday routine might not exactly explode with joy when Miss Hirschberg is right?
Do you have anything to do with dollars and cents in your job?
No.
Four down and six to go, Mr. Gable.
Is there anything medical in your job?
No.
Five down and five to go, Miss Kilgallen.
Do you have anything to do with the educational system?
Yes.
Do you ever go to the homes of parents of school children?
Yes.
And when there, do you inform them of something that they may not know up to that point?
Some, yes, perhaps.
Does it have anything to do with their children not showing up in class, maybe? Are you a truant officer?
Yes. Of course, actually, I must say that is an old term, which I think all five of us would use very readily, but I believe that now it's attendance officer.
Attendance.
And I know that Miss...
you
know, there's a difference. I was talking to Miss Hirschberg. She has a master's degree in sociology and in education as preparation for this work. It's more than just getting Junior by the ear and getting him into school.
Well,
it's
I
a matter
think it should
of...
be called a non-attendance officer.
That's...
Excuse me, but the title is really attendance teacher.
Attendance teacher.
Even a little bit more involved.
Attendance teacher. I'm sorry, I made the mistake there, Bennett. Yeah, so that one you took at random, we can
it
forgive you.
It did lead me astray, though, when you said that people would be glad to see her.
Parents.
They usually are.
Parents.
Because I should think a parent would hate to hear that the child is not going to school.
I would think that you'd have, split reactions. Many parents, ignorant of the fact that the child had been skipping school, would be glad to find it out. I know Bennett's parents were tickled to death to learn he hadn't been going so they could make him go. Miss Hirschberg, thank you very much. It's nice to have had you with us on What's My Life. And I didn't really mean that about Bennett. As a matter of fact, he skipped primary school and high school and went right to Columbia University. So there, that's how bright he was. And good night, Miss Arlene.
Columbia
Fenster.
Broadcasting System, that is.
Yeah.
Good night, John. Good night, dear Martin, for now.
Yes, sir. Good night, John.
Good night. Hope you don't have too much trouble, dear. Good night, Bennett.
They tell me you were an old hooky player yourself, John. Good night.
No, he was a hockey player.
Hooky, not hockey.
I got it, and I guess all of you did too, so I can do nothing but apologize and still thank you for being with us on What's My Line.
What's My Line is a CBS Television Network production in association with Mark Goodson and Bill Cotton. Johnny Olson speaking. The preceding program was pre-recorded.